All right, welcome to BIM Thoughts. You can see us this time because we're on YouTube, unless you're listening to us on the normal channel. We do have this recording available on YouTube because Mr. Half Hour himself, Paul Aubin, he texts me and says, I just got done listening to BIM Thoughts. I have the solution for you for your VR things. So we're going to let him tell us all about what the solution is. It was one of those with the Google Cardboard. So,
all right.
So we're excited about that. And we also have Charlie Williams with us, which you can see him. He's smiling and showing his white teeth. And he took his tie off so that he fit more in with casual Friday. I took mine off too
because maybe I should put mine on because I haven't worn one in I can't remember how long.
I haven't worn one since the last time I wore one.
Yeah.
All right. So tell us all about this. Why you think this is a great thing and what it does.
Yeah, great. Thanks, Bill. So I was listening. Actually, you've had two episodes recently on VR, and I was listening to those. Yeah. And of course, I've had opportunities to go into some of these booths with the Vives and the other things that people have. And I have, over the last few months, been working with a company called, their official company name is ImmersiCAD, but their product is called VCAD, the letter V, mm-hmm. CAD. And it's a very robust but simple solution that runs on Google Cardboard. So what I really like about it is all it takes is a smartphone that everybody's already mm-hmm. got and a cheap Google Cardboard or a more expensive one if, you know, you've got one, right? And an account to VCAD and you are doing VR. So they have free accounts and they have paid accounts and we can go through the details as we go through the session today, but you can upload Revit models or models in other formats. Mm-hmm. It takes a little time processing. Once the model is up there, you load it into your Google Cardboard in your phone. It works on both iPhones and Android devices. And there's two really significant features that really stuck out to me that why I'm so excited about this product. One is that you can navigate. So mm-hmm. without having to set any points in the models anywhere. You don't have to teleport from location to location. You literally just press a button and you are moving around in real time cool. through the model and you can fly through it and you can do whatever you want. And the other is there's a spectator mode. So if you're in a room full of people, instead of watching one guy with the headset on going, ooh, ah, and everybody else is wondering what they're looking at, you can have the projector going on in the room and we see what they're seeing through the goggles on the cool. projector screen. So that's what I'm going to demonstrate. And that's why we're doing this in video today. Mm-hmm. So
and
that's
the overview. Point?
Yeah. What's that? Oh, and the third point is it's very affordable, okay. you know? Yeah. Because you know, it runs on, again, the hardware component is your phone. Everybody's got one already. Mm-hmm. So as long as you have a relatively modern phone, it will work. I'm actually using a phone that's sub spec. I'm on a 5S and it works just fine. It sometimes it's a little laggy, but it mostly works just fine in the 5S. But if you've got, I think 6 is what they recommend or higher, and I'm not sure what the Android specs are, but that's on their website, so you can find okay. those. But if you've got a Samsung or an LG or whatever your phone happens to be, and then again, you take your pick on the choices of cardboards, right? So
right.
I've got three that I have here, right? Okay. I just pulled a generic picture of a cardboard here. Okay. But you know, this is one that I got for free in the at a conference, right? Uh-huh. So the trick is you want the button because that's what's going to allow the navigation, okay? Because that touches the screen, you know, kind of pushes on the screen and enables the navigation mode. So I don't know what that's officially called.
Are going to call it a button.
Yeah, but like, you know, here on this little picture that I'm showing in PowerPoint, there's like a little button there. Then this is incredibly cool. This thing.
Well, here's what the button does if the viewers and listeners are interested.
Yeah, it kind of pushes on the screen. Exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah.
A little thingies.
There's a little nubby thing there. Yeah. And on the cardboard, it's like that stuff that's on the gloves, right? You know, those gloves that you that mm-hmm. you can use it with your screens out in the cold, you know?
Yeah, or the styluses you get too from the conferences.
Yeah, exactly. So this one was way cool. This is portable. So it folds up like this, and you can put it in your pocket and take it with you.
That's
and
then, very Victorian.
Yeah, and then you just clip it on your phone like this. Yeah. Now, it doesn't give you the full experience because it doesn't cover the peripheral. Yeah, okay. And it but you know, and then as far as the button goes, you literally just touch the screen in the corner of the screen, because that's all that button is doing, is touching the screen. So you can kind of get the experience, and the nice thing is you don't have to be, you know, carrying this around with you to the restaurant or something. But if you want to, you know, you're at the restaurant, you want to say, "Oh, you got to look at this thing, it's so cool." Mm-hmm. This can fit in your pocket, right? And that's and it was like $12. I couldn't believe how cheap this was, right?
Wow.
So if you lose it or break it, it's not like you're heartbroken, you know. Now this was more expensive, and the one you have is probably more expensive. What I like about this one is it's made out of foam. So if you drop your phone, it's going to protect it. And it also just is more comfortable. And I can wear it with my glasses on, which I also like. So that's the one I'm going to be demonstrating from, you know.
Okay. So. I can't use glasses with mine. Mine's the ViewMaster.
Oh, yeah. You know, I almost got that one. Yeah, that was cool, too, because it's like it's the original VR, right?
Right. Nostalgia.
Yeah, exactly.
It's the steampunkish one.
Yeah. Oh, that's cool. Yeah.
Well, not quite steampunk. Maybe.
Now you have to hold it, or does it have a strap? Do you have a strap?
No, I have to hold it.
You have to hold it, yeah.
I have a lanyard.
Yeah.
I just missed all these kind of low-cost things at first. But the more I play with it, I'm getting more and more comfortable with it, and it seems like it's much easier for people to adopt. They're much more comfortable just playing with a piece of cardboard than they are looking at the HTC Vive.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and
so
it's
which one do you have there, Charlie?
Oh, you Charlie? Go ahead.
Yeah, which one do you have, Charlie?
We've been playing a lot with the Daydream, it's exclusive to the Pixel. No, I didn't. I went and tried to grab ours, but it looks like it escaped for the day.
All right.
I took it home to play with the kids on the weekend. But these more simple form factors are fun. It's and I like the softer materials, too. I think there's something to that as well from just an ergonomics perspective.
Right.
Yeah, we were talking about that before we started recording, and I had the simple cardboard with me at Thanksgiving and put my phone in it and started passing it around the room, and everybody, you know, from the kids that were there to my mother-in-law, who's in her 80s, were perfectly comfortable just taking it and looking around, and everybody was, you know, real excited to do it. And I think we were both agreeing that when you go into one of those pods with the sensors all around and the wires and the handheld controllers, it's a little intimidating. So that's another nice thing about these devices, is not only does it remove the cost barriers of entry and it's the simplicity factor, but it's also a little bit less intimidating. So I totally dig it. I mean, I think it's really cool.
And the Daydream that we've been playing with, it is built specifically for the Google Pixel, but you can also use it with iPhones or the Samsung. You miss out on some of the functionality. It has a remote when you're using the Pixel that's really nice, but the other products do work in it. So if you're just doing a spherical rendering, would work, or if you're connecting to an app like you're explaining with VCAD, that would work too.
Yeah, I've been exploring remotes, and I haven't found one yet that works with the iPhone, although some of them that I bought claim they do, and then I get them and they don't really work. But after a while, this gets tiring, you know, like holding down the button, you know, with your arms up here. So I really want something that you can have in your hand. But so there's all these little Bluetooth remotes, and maybe one of the listeners knows ones that work with the iPhone. But I've bought like three of them now, so I'm trying to find one that works. But
you could get a hook and just...
Yeah. Kind of the manual, old school. Yeah. All right. Well, do you want to
show us? Yes, I'm ready.
Fire it up. All right. Okay.
I downloaded the app.
So I'm going to go into my account here in VCAD. So it's just VCAD.com. And, you know, you can register or, you know, log in, obviously, right? I've already registered. So when I click log in, it remembers who I am and it went right in. So it takes me to my projects page. And, you know, these are the projects that I've previously uploaded. And then these are ones down here that people have shared with me. And I can share them individually with people, you know, delete or edit them over here. If I have a new model that I want to upload, so I wanted to show that first because it's really simple. I just go to this CAD to VR. And that takes me to this page, and you could see that there's just a few fields you fill out. So I'm going to call this, BIMThoughts. And then the file types are Revit, SketchUp, OBJ, FBX, right?
Isn't that, you know what's funny about this?
Yeah.
It says CAD to VR, but they don't accept DWGs.
Yeah, isn't that? it's CAD in the truest sense. Like, I've always kind of a little sidebar there. I mean, if you remember when we used to argue, did CAD mean computer-aided design or did it mean computer-aided drafting? It seems like nowadays everybody thinks of it as computer-aided drafting, therefore, BIM is, better than CAD, right? But if we think of it as computer-aided design, then really BIM is a subset of CAD. So to me, that's not so cut and dried there, So
I
anyway,
agree.
maybe they're thinking of it in the terms of computer-aided design. So
All right, or
anyhow,
give the benefit of the
I'm going to
doubt.
choose Revit here. I'm going to browse to the file, and I just created a simple model called BIMThoughts. And then this is kind of cool because you can actually load a custom thumbnail as well, which will show up on your screen when you choose it. And then here, I haven't tried this yet, but my contact at VCAD told me about this, and it sounds really cool. You can click there and put in an address, and if there is Google Street View imagery, it'll put that imagery around your model. Okay, so I didn't have a URL to put in there for this, so I'm just going to do the valley, the one of the pre-baked ones. But
Right.
anyway,
It's time for
I am
everybody to
anxious to
try.
try that feature, with the Street View. So I'm going to click Immersify. Now, it just takes a few minutes to upload the file because it's so small. If you have a really big model that you're uploading, it'll take a little longer. And then it'll email me shortly to let me know the file is ready. In the meantime, it says estimates about 10 minutes. I don't even think it's going to take that long. But in the meantime, we're going to look at one of the models that I already have in here, right? So step one is to just go to the VCAD app on my phone. And you can download the app, like I said, on either iPhone or Android. So, as that starts to load, it'll come to your gallery view there first and show you models that you have access to, right? So, this one here, you remember we did the episode of BIM Thoughts a while ago on my trip to Italy where we did all the reality capture. So, this one, Baptistry, is actually from the point clouds that we took of the Baptistry in Volterra. And then I've been making a Revit model from that. It's not complete yet, but this is, it's fairly well along. But the textures on the walls actually come from the photographs there in Volterra, but the floors and other stuff, I just use the standard Autodesk stuff. So now I'm going to click over here to Spectator. And this will just display the screen. And here's the thing that I just find really cool. You see, it's going to change in a minute here because it's going to sense that my phone is logged in. So there's no wires, right? It's just my phone. I keep forgetting where my camera is. It's just my phone here, no wires, but because I'm logged in both places, right? Oops, sideways there. There we go. Okay. And now it's already tracking the motion of my phone, right?
Look at
So you can
that.
already see. So of course, what we want to see is what it looks like when I'm in the headset, but I have to take my headset off here and get everything configured. So just give me a moment here.
Okay, this is where Paul looks weird. He can't hear me now. I can say anything I want. He's pointing. He's pointing again. He's putting the phone into the headset. He has the
The crowd
headset
goes
on.
wild.
And his glasses are still on his head. Here comes the headset. And welcome back, Paul.
We need
How's
some
that?
LA artists.
That's great.
Okay. I'm sure I look wonderful, right?
Yeah, we'll
So,
cut all that part out.
yeah. So I'm just going to back up a little bit here. I do recommend being in a swivel chair because, it's a little easier to kind of
Can't see
spin
this.
around. But now you guys should be seeing what I'm seeing, as I look around. And of course, if I start to look up here, right? I'm seeing
Look at
everything there.
that.
And now here's the part that really struck me about this feature, about this app. If I hold the button down, that's all I have to do. I'm touching the screen of my phone now, and I'm walking around in the space.
That's cool.
Okay. And if you get a little seasick, just take a break, and then kind of look at this statue here. This came right from the point cloud, turned into a
Really?
mesh. And then I always like to fly up here and look at the cornice, so I'm going to fly up.
Oh, you can fly.
So there's settings. You can force people to stay on the ground if you want them to, but I like to be up here, and then look up in there. But then here, this is where you get a little woozy sometimes, like, whoa, oh my goodness, but I'm kind of floating. Now, I don't think you can see it. But the way that you, when you're in the headset, the way you change settings is you have to look down at the floor and there's a button there. And then if I click that, with the button, now it's not working for some reason. It's flashing, but it's not actually
Maybe you have
clicking
to
the button.
stand up.
I think I'm going to turn away and then do it again. Okay, well.
Stand up and try it.
Stand up and try it.
Yeah, maybe you're not bending down far.
But now you can't see me, right?
Yeah. We just want to see if we
can. Oh, there it was. Yeah, I didn't highlight it enough. Okay, I was a little off the button. So then that kind of puts a menu on the screen, but I don't think the spectator mode shows the menu, does it?
It says waiting.
Okay, so I'm going to choose BIMThoughts now because the model is up there. Okay, so we're going to switch models.
It got done in less than an Aubin.
Yeah, it was really quick. Mm-hmm. It said 10 minutes, but I don't think it's been 10 minutes. So this is that, what do you call it? That surrounding that I chose, valley, right?
Oh, okay.
Okay, so it's just kind of, you know, I'm in the middle of a colonnade there, right? But like, that's just the valley. Mm-hmm. So what I'm going to do is walk out into the, okay, I think I got the units wrong on the model. See how slow I'm moving?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so you can, that's a setting you can adjust. So if you get the units wrong, it's takes longer to walk. But anyway, let me turn, whoop, a little too far away. Okay,
look at
so
that.
There we go.
And you went the wrong direction.
I did go the wrong direction. So let's go. This is a little excruciating to walk this slow. My apologies.
That's all right.
Maybe we could speed it up in the recording, right?
We might be able to.
Camping over there?
Yeah, I don't know. Maybe. Kind of looks like it. Yep, that's a tent.
Oh yeah,
isn't it?
Look at that.
So you know, there's the model, right?
Is that right now? It's in the camp.
Kind of get in nice and close there and look around if we want to.
Okay.
The detail's much better than I expected it to be.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, and again, it would probably be even better if I had a better phone. You know, because this is an iPhone 5S that I'm using here. So let me move away a little bit, and then I'll come back. Okay. So there it is, right? So let's look at one more from Volterra.
Okay.
This is let's see, gotta go there. The Palazzo de Priori, which is the town hall in Volterra. So back in the Renaissance, there was this, you know, they were making these palazzos where the secular authorities were, and they were kind of in competition with the church authorities. So literally in Volterra, you've got the town hall on one plaza, and then back to back is the cathedral facing another plaza. It's kind of like they've got their backs to each other, you know? Oh, that's funny. I don't know if you guys can see that, but Gmail just alerted me about something.
No, we're still waiting.
Okay. Yeah, this model's a little bigger, so it's taking a little bit longer to load. Okay so here it is.
There it is.
So they're still... So this one you can see is a little choppier because it's a bigger model. But I'm looking in the council chamber right now. So off in the distance there, that table is where the mayor would sit, and the benches surrounding him are where the town council members would be. And where I am, there would be a bunch of folding chairs or wooden chairs, rather, where the public can sit. I just haven't built those yet. Okay, so we can kind of go walk over here to look at the benches where the council members sit. And this, you know, they still hold town meetings here. This is is like from the 12th century that they built this, right? And I love these little lamps here. Let me
and you're
here.
Still just doing a click on the device to move forward.
Yeah
Wow.
And you know, get this nice vaulted ceiling. Now to get these custom textures, you have to FB exit. I don't know why, but this is a standard Revit texture. That one came across just fine. So I guess maybe there's some setting in Revit that it understands the default textures. But when you build your own custom one, if you export it to FBX, like these on the ceiling weren't showing up the first time I uploaded. So I did have to do it as an FBX first. So that is an option if you've got a lot of custom textures. This is the mayor's office, but I haven't built his desk or anything yet. And there's another one of those statues.
Look at that.
Yeah.
And then how it looks,
this has got a nice beam. Yeah, that's the statue from the office. I built that from the point cloud. Got this nice beam ceiling here. And so anyway, I mean, you know, obviously there's a lot more to build in this model, but this is the cool thing is that you can kind of do this progress. And so I'm going to jump out of here now. Let's see. Okay. And all right. Well, actually, let me just, I don't know if we have to, if we'll have to cut any of this if it's taking too long, but
I don't know.
This one here is a little experiment of Penn Station, and it's kind of fun to show because
you're
it's
the
so
one
big.
That set the time, Paul.
Huh?
Yeah. You're the one that sets the time. We're at 20 minutes in.
Oh, okay. Two thirds of an Aubin. All right.
Two thirds of an Aubin.
So this one is like a really rough of Penn Station.
Uh huh. Okay?
And I put in some little people there to try and show the scale of, you know, because just how big it is here.
Right.
Now, the lighting is a little dark in here. So there is a, for some reason, I'm not seeing it in the headset. I have to actually take the phone out. It, like,
oh.
My buttons are overlapping one another in a weird way. And I don't know if that's a thing with the iPhone or if it's something else. But it's there's a
you have
button.
A small phone.
Yeah, there's a screen you can go to where you can dial up the ambient lighting, and you can also change the speed, you know, so to deal with the fact that we're moving so slow, right? I could change both of those settings and save them with this model. But here I kept everything really schematic, right? You know, so instead of showing the Corinthian capitals, I'm just showing those like really coarse versions, but, you know, nice big grand space, right? So anyhow, that is, hold on one sec. See, I didn't realize I wasn't facing the camera.
It's all right. I was looking at my phone too.
Yeah. So that is the, so yeah, I don't think the spectator mode would show the settings anyway.
No, it doesn't show any of that. Cool
yeah.
Stuff.
So I'm going to show it to you this way.
Okay.
Oops, there. Okay. So I don't know if you can see that, but like, it's a little blurry. Get it to focus there. So you can see there's a bank of icons across the top that show the speed and then, the fly mode, whether you let people fly or whether they're stuck on the floor or, you know, and then the lighting, there's a button at the bottom where you can click to adjust the lighting, you know?
Oh, okay.
So you can do all that in the headset by just looking down at the floor and pressing the button to click the, you know, to click the buttons, the choices you want, you know? And then of course, if I close out of the app, then spectator just goes back to wait mode here, you know? So,
cool.
Yeah. And as far as pricing goes, I mean, they can see it by just going to VCAD, but for a personal account, it's 10 bucks a month. For a professional, it's 50 bucks a month. Or the free account just lets you view models that other folks have created, you know?
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so you don't need to pay anything to view models, but if you want to upload your own models, then that's a paid account, okay?
So how long does it take to load a normal building up there?
You know, they're really quick, actually. Palazzo de Priori that I showed you that took a little while to load up on the phone. I want to say it took maybe about 35 minutes to process that. Okay. It really didn't take very long. You know?
How big is that file in?
That is a great question. Let me see if I can find the answer for you.
And
so, now we're going to look at your hard drive. That's okay. We can edit that part out.
All right. So... just about 60 megs.
60 megs, okay.
Yeah, it's not too bad.
So
not bad at all.
When you're selecting a model to upload, are you taking an individual room and it's just placing you wherever the ground plane is and at the middle? Or how are you picking where you end up in which room you end up if you have a multi-level building or a multi-room building?
Yeah, so it just drops you kind of in the center. So like you saw with the colonnade that I uploaded, I just was underneath the columns in the middle of the model. What you can do though, is you can, in the app, you can navigate to where you want your start location to be and then go to the settings and say, make this my start location.
Make that my starting point.
Yeah. So that's what I did with Palazzo de Priori because I was always ending up on the first floor that I hadn't modeled yet. So you were kind of in this empty box and you were like, what? I don't see. And you had to fly through the floor to get to the interesting stuff because that stuff's on the second floor. So I went up there and I picked my start point and then I saved it again. So,
okay. Cool. And then if you want to move from one floor to the next, would you just create that as another model with a different starting point, or do they have scenes that they can select from?
Well, if it's all part of one model, you could literally walk there. Like, so what I'm hoping to do eventually is build the staircase that goes down to the first floor. And then I really want to, you know, practice actually walking down the stairs.
Yeah.
You know, but yeah, you could do two models too, if you wanted to. I started trying to upload Project Zone. And it's ginormous. So it choked on that one. So that's probably what'll have to happen with Project Zone is we'll have to break it into pieces.
You know? What's ginormous?
Way bigger than an Aubin.
Wait, is it a gig of Revit data or
yeah, probably. I can't remember exactly how big Project Zone is right now, but it's very detailed and really large. But there are specs on here somewhere that tell us what let me see if I can get back to the beginning here and see where it tells us. I think I have to be out of my account, maybe. There's suggestions of how big a file can be, but I pushed it a little bit. I wish I had that information right off the top of my head. Sorry about that.
Okay.
Let's see. It doesn't say here, but I can get that answer. We can put it in show notes later. So, yeah. So, cool. Trying to think if I'm forgetting anything.
I don't know.
They're working on this actively. So I was just talking to my contact over there the other day, and he was telling me about some new features that are on the way. Some of them weren't ready for this presentation, so we just decided to go with what I'm already comfortable and familiar with.
Okay.
But, like, for example, they added a spectator mode on your phone. So this just showed up in the app one day, and I was, oh, that's cool. Get out of here now. I got to get back to home here. And go to there. Okay. So, you know, you start here, right? Where you're just picking the project you want to be in. And then, you know, let me go back to the baptistry because it loads quickly. So there's going to be buttons that are going to, like right there, there's a little button. Let me get a little closer. Right? It kind of like looks like a Google Cardboard. Okay,
yeah.
So right now it's in kind of spectator mode on the phone, but right now I have to do this to see to navigate, and that's kind of weird. So like if you're sitting across the table from somebody and you just want to show them the model, it's kind of weird to say, "Oh, look, here's the ceiling," and you have to kind of like do these contortionist moves. So they're going to change that so that it's all pinch zooming and navigation in spectator mode, and then only when you go to the cardboard button and then it turns to split screen. That's what I was kind of miming when I put the headset on because I didn't have my I didn't have my audio, but that you see how it turned it to split screen. Now it would be, this would be the mode where it's, and I said, yeah, that makes perfect sense because, so that's not in the app right now, but it's coming very soon. That's going to change that.
Has
so
that functionality, you can bounce out from the split view, the stereopic view to a single view, which on an iPad is actually not a bad experience.
Yeah, it really isn't. And you know, again, you can meet people where they're at that point, because even with cardboard, like we talked about, where it's less intimidating, there's some people that just don't want to put that in front of their face. They don't want to do it. So, or they get seasick or, you know, so,
having that,
you know, show it to them another way.
Going back to the file formats for VCAD, I saw SketchUp, I saw Revit, but what about the different panorama formats that are coming out of like Lumion and Autodesk 360 or any of those? Will it take
I'll
those
have to ask
well?
Them. Yeah, right now it doesn't. These are the formats. I'll have to ask them if that's even in the works or not. But I mean, they're actually taking the 3D model and converting it to what I assume is their proprietary format. So I don't know what happens behind the scenes, you know, the magic sauce that makes that happen. So I don't know if they can work with those panorama formats because they're already processed. I think they need to start with 3D data, you know.
Yeah.
Well, in a panoramic photo, you wouldn't be able to walk through it.
Right.
Yeah, I don't think so. Right. So I think that's why they need the 3D. Yeah, but they're doing something to optimize it. I don't know what they're doing, but you know, to get the fluid motion like that, it's really pretty impressive. You know,
it's really interesting time in the sense that you have all these choices now. So you can do the spherical rendering, and you have levels of quality in that, and you have different types of viewers, and then you step into the, you know, real VR experience with an Oculus or HTC Vive, and then you've got these different leveling qualities of the actual model itself. You can go raw out of Revit or SketchUp, and then you can add rendering materials on top of them. It's pretty spectacular.
Yeah, it really is. Yeah, it really is. I mean, it's just, I just think this solution, you know, there's almost no reason not to give it a try if anybody's interested in VR, because there's very few barriers to entry. It it checks many of the boxes you want, and it's certainly worth giving a try to. And you know, you this probably have almost everything you need already.
Right. You know? When you talk about firm scale, this is, you know, something that can go across all scales, where HTC Vive, that has some barriers to entry with its cost and the amount of, you know, equipment that goes along with it. So, yeah, I agree with you. Why wouldn't you try this?
Yeah.
Okay. So I have one other document that we can share in the show notes that these guys put together that is a Word document, or I think we'll give the PDF version, but this is just a real quick rundown of kind of what you need. So pretty much summarizes everything that we just said. You know, like you need a phone, you need a cardboard, you need, you know, and it makes a few suggestions. So we can provide this with the show notes, and then, you know, folks can have kind mm-hmm. of a quick rundown, almost like a checklist of what they need. So
right. So that's how an author looks at things. He sees all of the paragraph symbols and things like that.
You don't look at it that way?
No.
Yeah, I like to know where the paragraphs are and make sure there's not any funny formatting in there. So, you know, for an author,
yes,
that drives me crazy.
Is this the tab versus space? Yeah, there it is.
Exactly. Yeah, there's a lot of those little, like even this bugs me right here where there's an extra space at the end of the sentence. I don't want, you know, but it's in review mode, so it actually just X that out instead of actually deleting it. But
oh my goodness,
So,
all right, Paul.
All right.
Well, we've talked for an Aubin, and we talked to an Aubin, which is quite amazing.
Yeah.
Thank you, Paul. Thank you, Charlie. Thank you, YouTubers and listeners to BIMThoughts.
My pleasure. Thank you for having me once again. Soon.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Be careful out there.
That's all.